Hello students, I welcome you all to this online NEET classes. This is our second NEET session from the chapter 2, that is biological classification. I am Mrs. Divya dealing with this session. So let us continue with the next set of questions. In the previous video, we have discussed some of the important questions for the NEET exams, right? So in this module, I have picked up the questions which had been appeared in the previous NEET exams. Okay, so I have sorted them year wise, right from the last year's question paper, that is NEET 2020, starting from there till 2013 in the decreasing order. So let us discuss these questions. Hope this will be helpful for you all. Okay, so let us start with the first question, that is which had appeared in NEET 2020. The question is, which of the following statements is correct about viroids? The options are, they have DNA with protein coat, they have free DNA without protein coat, they have RNA with protein coat, they have free RNA without protein coat. So here, what are viroids actually? So viroids are smaller, minute particles, smaller than the viruses. Okay, so here these particles, if you see, they have just a genetic material present in them. Okay, so they do not have the protein coat, but they have only the genetic material. So the option should be here either B option or C option, right? So it should be either they have free DNA without protein coat or they have free RNA without protein coat. So out of this, these two, which is the genetic material present in the viroids? So it is actually RNA particles. See, viroids, they are also called as naked RNA particles. Okay, they are also called as naked RNA particles or naked RNA infectious particles. So they have free RNA without protein coat. So what should be the option? They have free RNA without protein coat. See, the major difference between viruses and viroids is that virus have genetic material which is enclosed by a protein coat. But viroids are naked RNA particles, that is protein coat is absent and the genetic material is only RNA. Fine. So the option is option D is the correct answer. So next, coming to the next question. It is from 2019. So in 2020, only one question was asked. Next, coming to 2019. Which of the following statements is incorrect? Viroids lack a protein coat. Viruses are obligate parasites. Infective constituent in viruses is the protein coat. Prions consist of abnormally folded proteins. So see here, they have asked which is incorrect. Viroids lack a protein coat. So just now we discussed, yes, it is a true statement. Viroids lack a protein coat. Next, viruses are obligate parasites. So what do you mean by this term, obligate parasites? Obligate in the sense which are completely dependent on the host. So they cannot survive without the presence of host. So such parasites are said to be obligate. And compulsorily, it is required. The parasite is, host is required. Okay. The opposite of this obligate is facultative. Remember this term. Opposite of obligate is facultative, means they can survive even without the host independently. They can remain independently as well as they can be along with the host. But obligate in the sense without the host, they don't survive. So in case of viruses, you know, they are living only inside the host body, right? So when it is outside the host, they are said to be inert particles. Right, so that is also a true statement. Viruses are obligate parasites. Coming to the third point, third option, Infective constituent in viruses is the protein coat. So is it a true statement? No. Because which is the infective particles in virus? It is the genetic material, not the protein coat. Okay. So it is either RNA or DNA. Because the viruses, they inject their genetic material, DNA or RNA, into the host genome. So that mixes with the host genome and it causes infection. So third option, it has to be third option. Okay. So next, see, let us discuss what is this D option also. Prions consist of abnormally folded proteins. So what is this prions? In your NCERT book, they have not mentioned about this prions, right? But prions are nothing but they are also infectious particles. They are also smaller particles than the viruses. So they are just folded proteins. Okay, see, viroids, you know, viroids, they don't have protein coat, they have genetic material. But prions, they don't have genetic material, but they just are protein particles which cause infection in the both plants as well as animals. Those are prions. Okay, so what is the answer here, children? It is third option. Infective constituent in viruses is the protein coat they have given. So that is a wrong statement. Okay, now coming to the next question. Another question from NEET 2019 itself. Which of the following statements is incorrect? Once again, morels and truffles are edible delicacies. Claviceps is a source of many alkaloids and LSD. Conidia are produced exogenously and ascospores endogenously. Yeasts have filamentous bodies with long thread-like hyphae. So they have asked once again, which is incorrect statement. So see here, morels and truffles are edible delicacies. Is it true? Yes, they are edible. Okay, morels and truffles, which belong to fungi, group fungi, that is, they are belonging to the division Ascomycetes in the fungus. So they are edible mushrooms. Next statement, claviceps is a source of many alkaloids and LSDs. Yes, claviceps, it is a fungus, right? So it is a source of many alkaloids. Yes, it is a source of alkaloids and LSD. So what is this LSD? So LSD full form is lysergic acid dimethylamide. Lysergic acid dimethylamide. Okay. So, lysergic acid dimethylamide. So, it is extracted from this claviceps or mushroom. So, this is used as a drug. Okay, so second statement is also correct. Next is conidia are produced exogenously and ascospores are produced endogenously. Yes, see, you have seen the conidia which is formed in the penicillium. So there, if you see the structure of penicillium, you can see they have a conidiophore. On that, small minute spores, that is conidia, they are produced exogenously. Yes, then ascospores, you know, ascospores, they are also called as the sac fungi because they have sac or bag like structures which form the spore bearing structure. So inside this sac you can find the minute spores are produced endogenously. So it is inside this sac-like structure. Fine. So third statement is also right, and that is conidia are produced exogenously outside the sporangiophore, and ascospores are produced endogenously, that is inside the sporangiophore. Next one is yeasts have filamentous bodies with long thread-like hyphae. Is it true? No. Why? because yeasts are unicellular fungus. Remember this point. Yeast is the only unicellular fungi. So they have just a single cell. Okay, so they are unicellular fungi. So what is the answer? It has to be fourth one. Fourth statement is incorrect. Yes, coming to the next question. So this is from NEET 2018. See, in NEET 2019, two questions. NEET 2018. Which of the following organisms are known as chief producers in the oceans? Is it dinoflagellates, diatoms, euglenoids, cyanobacteria? So here, see, what are these dinoflagellates and diatoms? So dinoflagellates, diatoms, euglenoids, all the three, you know, they belong to kingdom Protista. Right? And they are also called as photosynthetic protists. So here cyanobacteria, it belongs to kingdom Monera. It is also photosynthetic in nature, right? So it is prokaryote, which is photosynthetic in nature, whereas dinoflagellates, diatoms, euglenoids, all are photosynthetic protists. And among these three, euglenoids, that is consisting of unicellular eukaryotes, they are, most of them, they are freshwater forms, okay? Whereas dinoflagellates and diatoms, these two, they are, most of them, they are marine forms. And among these two, we have to pick here diatoms. That is, diatoms, they are marine forms and they form the chief producers in the oceans because they are phytoplanktons which are floating on the water surface in the marine water bodies. Okay, so there they photosynthesize enormously and they form the chief producers. So it has to be option B, diatoms, right? So like this you can go on eliminating the wrong answers and you can come to the right answer. See, cyanobacteria cannot be because it is Monera, you don't find them. It is a Moneran prokaryote, you don't find them in the oceanic water bodies. Then if you see dinoflagellates, diatoms and euglenoids, euglenoids are freshwater forms. Coming to dinoflagellates and diatoms, among these two, it is the diatoms because mainly diatoms are marine forms. Okay, so this is how you can come to the answer. So what is the answer, children? It is option B. Next question. So next question is also from NEET 2018. Ciliates differ from all other protozoans in using flagella for locomotion, having a contractile vacuole for removing excess water, having two types of nuclei, using pseudopodia for capturing prey. So here also, go on seeing the options. Using flagella for locomotion, can it be because ciliates, as the name itself says, they are having cilia. So cilia here is meant for locomotion. Fine. So what is the difference between cilia and flagella? Cilia is small, hairy or bristle-like structures which are present throughout the membrane and they are meant for motility or locomotion. Flagella are long thread-like structures which you find in the other group of protozoans. Okay. So that is which we call them as the flagellates. So the first one, it cannot be the answer. It's wrong. Next, having a contractile vacuole for removing excess water. See, you know what are contractile vacuoles? They are large vacuoles which are present in the protozoans. They are meant for removing the extra fluids as well as the excretory waste. So we say that they help in osmoregulation. Contractile vacuoles help in osmoregulation. So here all the protozoans, they consist of this contractile vacuoles. Even in amoeba, amoeboid protozoans, then even in the flagellated protozoans as well as in the ciliated protozoans, everywhere you find contractile vacuoles are present. So even this is the wrong answer. Coming to the next type, that is having two types of nuclei. Yes, this is the answer, because in the ciliates, one common example, typical example of ciliates you can take is paramecium. So in paramecium, you can see that they consist of two nuclei. One is larger and the other one is smaller. The larger one is called as the macronucleus and the smaller one is called as the micronucleus. So this feature is found only in the ciliates. Okay, so the answer is option C. See the next option, using pseudopodia for capturing prey. So pseudopodia is absent in the ciliates, right? It is present in only the group amoeboid protozoans. Okay, so the answer is option C. Yes, coming to the next question. See, again from NEET 2018 only, see how many questions were asked. After karyogamy followed by meiosis, spores are produced exogenously in Neurospora, Alternaria, Saccharomyces, Agaricus. So see children, remember these examples are picked from your NCERT textbook only. You can see them. Okay. So remember these examples because see, you should be knowing to which group of fungi these examples belong to. So in fungus, you know, sexual reproduction consists of three steps, right? So that is, first one is plasmogamy, where fusion of the cytoplasm takes place leading to two nuclei stage, that is dikaryon stage. Next is karyogamy, where fusion of the nuclei takes place, so forming a diploid zygote. Next, third one is meiosis, where the zygote undergoes meiotic divisions to produce spores, right? So after this meiosis, in which group do you find exogenously spores are produced? So fungi, you know, there are four groups of fungi: phycomycetes, ascomycetes, deuteromycetes, basidiomycetes, right? So among these, in basidiomycetes, you find that spores are produced exogenously. So here, see, Neurospora, it belongs to group Ascomycetes. Neurospora, it belongs to group Ascomycetes. So here, in Ascomycetes, I had shown you previously that sac, it is a sac fungi producing sac-like spore-bearing structures. Inside that, the spores are produced. So it is endogenously in Neurospora. Alternaria, it belongs to group Deuteromycetes. So Deuteromycetes, they are almost similar to the Ascomycetes. Okay, so there also the spores are produced endogenously. Saccharomyces is nothing but yeast. Yeast scientific name is Saccharomyces. It also belongs to Ascomycetes. And another thing is that Saccharomyces is unicellular fungus. So it mainly reproduces here by budding. Okay. Next, coming to Agaricus. So Agaricus belongs to group Basidiomycetes. So here also called as the toadstools or the puffballs, right? So here you can see this mushroom. So exogenously in this, here the gills like structures are present, which is called as the gills consist of the basidiospores. And on this basidiospores, you can see that these are the basidiospores. So on this basidiospores, you can basidium, you can see basidiospores are produced exogenously. Okay, so the answer is option D. This is the basidia or the basidium, which is the spore bearing structure. Then this is the basidiospores, and this whole fruiting body is called as the basidiocarp. Fine. Yes, coming to the next question. This is also from NEET 2018. See, select the wrong statement. Cell wall is present in members of fungi and plantae. Mushrooms belong to basidiomycetes. Mitochondria are the powerhouse of the cell in all kingdoms except Monera. Pseudopodia are locomotory and feeding structures in sporozoans. So go on seeing the options now. First option is, cell wall is present in members of fungi and plantae. Is it true? Yes. Both of these kingdoms, they have cell wall, but only the cell wall material differs. That is, in fungi, the cell wall is mainly made up of chitin. Yes. Whereas in plantae, the cell wall is made up of cellulose. That is the major difference, right? Next, mushrooms belong to basidiomycetes. Yes, true. Mushrooms belong to basidiomycetes. That is the puffballs or the bracket fungi is also called as. Next option is, mitochondria are the powerhouse of the cell in all kingdoms except Monera. Yes, this is also a true statement, because Monerans are prokaryotes. That is, all the membrane bound organelles are absent in Monera. So they don't have mitochondria present. Whereas all the other kingdoms, Protista, Mycota, Plantae and Animalia, they are eukaryotic in nature, and they have all the membrane bound cell organelles along with a well-defined nucleus. Fine. So option C is also wrong. Next option is, pseudopodia are locomotory and feeding structures in sporozoans. So here, protozoans are again divided into many different groups. So where, depending upon their locomotory structures, right? So it is the sporozoans which do not have any locomotory structure. So this is a wrong statement. Pseudopodia are locomotory structures in amoeboid protozoans, not in sporozoans. So amoeboid protozoans, example, you know, amoeba, entamoeba. So there you find they have temporary membranous extensions called as the pseudopodia. Whereas sporozoans, almost all sporozoans, they are parasitic in nature. They are parasites, for example, the malarial parasite, that is Plasmodium, right? So they don't have any locomotory structures. They move along with the body fluids, fine? So it has to be option D, okay? Yes, coming to the next question. So now, from NEET 2017, viroids differ from viruses in having DNA molecules with protein coat, DNA molecules without protein coat, RNA molecules with protein coat, RNA molecules without protein coat. See, this is a repeated question. It has been asked in 2020 question paper also, right? So here the answer is option D. That is, they are RNA molecules without protein coat. Fine, viroids are infectious RNA particles without protein coat. Now coming to next question. Which of the following are found in extreme saline conditions? Archaebacteria, Eubacteria, Cyanobacteria, Mycobacteria. So here, see the options. First one, Archaebacteria. So you all know, Archaebacteria, they are the primitive bacteria which were found in the extreme environmental conditions, like high temperatures, like thermal vents, then hot springs, sulfur springs, right? High acidic conditions, as well as extreme saline conditions also, right? So Archaebacteria are of three kinds, that is the methanogens, halophiles and the thermoacidophiles. So you know, the halophiles are the ones which are present in saline conditions. So it is the halophiles, the Archaebacteria. Yes, so Eubacteria and Cyanobacteria, those are the true bacteria which are present in the normal environmental conditions now everywhere. Okay, so it has to be option A. Coming to the next question from NEET 2017 itself. Which among the following are the smallest living cells known without a definite cell wall, pathogenic to plants as well as animals, and can survive without oxygen? So the options given are Bacillus, Pseudomonas, Mycoplasma, Nostoc. So see here, Bacillus, option A, it is a one which belongs to true bacteria. Okay, so that cannot be the answer. Pseudomonas is a bacteria which is present in the soil, which is meant for nitrogen fixation. So that is also not the answer. Mycoplasmas. So what are mycoplasmas, children? Mycoplasma are the group of cells which are very minute, smaller than the bacteria. So they are called as the smallest living cells. Okay, they are the smallest living cells. They do not have a cell wall. How do they differ from the normal bacteria? That is, they don't have a definite cell wall. They are infectious particles. They cause pneumonia like symptoms. So they are also called as the pleuropneumonia like organisms. So the first one discovered was this PPLO, pleuropneumonia like organisms. Then they can survive without oxygen. So they are present in the anaerobic conditions. Okay, so the answer is option C, mycoplasmas. Next, Nostoc, you know, Nostoc is a cyanobacteria, right? So it is option C. Next question, this is from NEET 2016. Which one of the following is wrong for fungi? They are eukaryotic. All fungi possess a purely cellulosic cell wall. They are heterotrophic. They are both unicellular and multicellular. So what should be the answer now? Yes. See, the first option, they are eukaryotic. Yes, this is a true statement. All fungi are eukaryotic in nature. Next, all fungi possess a purely cellulosic cell wall. Is this true? No. One of the important unique features of fungi is the cell wall material. Remember this. The cell wall in fungi is mainly made up of chitin. Cellulosic cell wall is a feature of plants. Chitinous cell wall is the defining feature of fungi. So it has to be option B. This is wrong for fungi. Okay. See the next two statements. They are heterotrophic. Yes, all fungi are heterotrophic. They cannot synthesize food. Heterotrophs, in that only, they might be saprophytic, they might be parasitic in nature, but they are heterotrophic. Then, they are both unicellular and multicellular. Yes, the group fungus, kingdom fungi, consists of both unicellular and multicellular eukaryotes, but there's only one unicellular fungi, that is yeast, is a unicellular fungus, is the only unicellular fungus. Okay. So, the answer is option B. All fungi have chitinous cell wall, not cellulosic cell wall. Okay. Hope you have understood. Another question from NEET 2016. Methanogens belong to Eubacteria, Archaebacteria, Dinoflagellates, Slime Molds. So, another similar question, that is regarding Archaebacteria. So, you know, Eubacteria means the true bacteria. Archaebacteria consists of three groups, that is methanogens, halophiles and thermoacidophiles. So, what is the answer? The answer is option B, right? Archaebacteria, methanogens, they are methane producing bacteria which are present in the gut of ruminant animals like the cattle, okay? Next, dinoflagellates and slime molds, they belong to kingdom Protista. Fine. Next question. Select the wrong statement. The walls of diatoms are easily destructible. Diatomaceous earth is formed by the cell walls of diatoms. Diatoms are chief producers in the oceans. Diatoms are microscopic and float passively in water. See, which is the correct, wrong statement. The walls of diatoms are easily destructible. Is it true? No. They are not easily destructible, or they are indestructible. It is said the diatoms, walls of diatoms are indestructible. Why? Because the cell wall material of diatoms is made up of silica. Okay, the cell wall material is made up of silica, which does not destroy, which is indestructible. And though the cell, the diatom cell dies, the cell wall material silica goes on depositing and accumulates in the earth's surface, and there it forms a huge accumulation of siliceous material, which is called as the diatomaceous earth, which has economic importance, okay, which is very useful economically for humankind. Fine. So the first option itself is right. That is, the walls of diatoms are easily destructible. No, they are not destructible. See the next options. Diatomaceous earth is formed by the cell wall of diatoms. Yes, just now as I told you, it is made up of silica, and silica goes on depositing, and after many years of accumulation, it is called as the diatomaceous earth. Diatoms are chief producers in the oceans. Yes, we had discussed this previously, right? So they are the phytoplanktons which float on the water surface and which are photosynthetic in nature. Diatoms are microscopic. Yes, they are unicellular forms, so they are microscopic, and they float passively in water. Yes, they don't have locomotory structures. They float in the water current itself. So they float on the water surface. Okay. Coming to the next question. It is also from NEET 2016. Select the wrong statement. Bacterial cell wall is made up of peptidoglycan. Pili and fimbria are mainly involved in motility of bacterial cells. Cyanobacteria lack flagellated cells. Mycoplasma is a wall-less microorganism. Now see the options. Bacterial cell wall is made up of peptidoglycan. Yes, it is true. One of the important features of bacterial cell is the cell wall is made up of polysaccharide, that is peptidoglycan. Next one. Pili and fimbria are mainly involved in motility of bacterial cells. No, this is a wrong statement. Okay, so it has to be option B. What are these pili and fimbriae? Pili, sometimes in some textbooks, both are given together, like pili or fimbriae. They are both used together, or there is just a slight difference between the two. But their function is almost the same. Okay, see, pili, children, they are long than the fimbriae, okay? So they are long thread-like structures. They are present on the surface of the bacterial cell wall, which are meant for attachment or adhesion to the host surface. Fine. Fimbriae are also nothing but they are bristle-like structures which are present on the surface of the bacterial cell wall. The fimbriae are also meant for attachment or adhesion or anchorage to the host surface. Okay, so both the function of both pili and fimbriae is the same. Both of them, they help in attaching themselves to the host, not in motility. For motility, bacteria have flagella. One or many flagella might be present which help in locomotion. Okay, then see, another function of pili is, there are some specialized pili present called as the sex pili, which help in sexual reproduction. That is, they form a conjugation tube which forms an attachment or a bridge between two bacterial cells, and it helps in transferring the genetic material from one bacteria to the other bacteria. Okay, so among two bacterial cells, the pili here form a tube or a bridge So the genetic material from one bacteria is transferred to the other bacteria. So this is the simplest mode of sexual reproduction which takes place in bacteria. So for that they have some special pili called as the sex pili. Okay, they are meant for sexual reproduction. Whereas the other common pili, as I told you, they are meant for attaching to the host. Even fimbriae are meant for attaching to the host. Fine. Next, cyanobacteria lack flagellated cells. Yes, cyanobacteria, nothing but the blue-green algae, they do not have locomotory structures. Okay. Then mycoplasma is a wall-less microorganism. Yes, we have studied previously. Mycoplasma, they do not have cell wall. They are pathogenic materials, right, which are similar to the bacteria, but without a definite cell wall. Fine. So it is option B. Next, another question from NEET 2016 itself. Which one of the following statements is wrong? Phycomycetes are also called algal fungi. Cyanobacteria are also called blue-green algae. Golden algae are also called desmids. Eubacteria are also called false bacteria. So here see the options one by one. Phycomycetes are also called algal fungi. Yes, this is a true statement. They are also called as algal fungi. Next, cyanobacteria are also called blue-green algae. Yes, you know, as they are photosynthetic in nature, they are also called as blue-green algae. Golden algae are also called desmids. Yes, because of their pigmentation, they are called as the golden algae. Then Eubacteria are also called false bacteria. No, Eubacteria are nothing but the true bacteria which we found in all the environmental conditions at now present environmental conditions, right? So Eubacteria are the normal true bacteria. So it has to be option D. Fine. Coming to the next question. Chrysophytes, euglenoids, genoflagellates and slime molds are included in the kingdom. Animalia, Monera, Protista, fungi. So this must be easier for you all. You know, kingdom Protista is divided into many groups. That is, it consists of the chrysophytes, euglenoids, genoflagellates. These three are photosynthetic protists. Then other two they have, that is slime molds and protozoans, which are non-photosynthetic or heterotrophic protists, right? So the answer is option C, kingdom Protista. Then next question. One of the major components of cell wall of most fungi is hemicellulose, chitin, peptidoglycan, cellulose. So this is also almost repeated question. That is, the cell wall of most fungi is chitin. So chitin is the unique feature. This cell wall material can all be called as one of the salient features or unique features of fungi, right? That is, cell wall mainly made up of chitin. Fine. Next question. Again from 2016 only. The primitive prokaryotes responsible for the production of biogas from the dung of ruminant animals include the Eubacteria, halophiles, thermoacidophiles, methanogens. So see here, see the options. Eubacteria, you know, they are the true present day bacteria. So that option is ruled out. So it comes among these three: halophiles, thermoacidophiles, methanogens, because these are the three groups of archaebacteria which were present in the primitive environmental conditions, extreme environmental conditions. So halophiles are present in the most saline conditions. Thermoacidophiles are found in the acidic conditions as well as in high temperatures like thermal vents or hot acid springs. Next, methanogens is the one which are found in the gut of ruminant animals. like the cattle. So the dung of cattle, you might be knowing, is generally used for the production of biogas because they yield methane. Okay, so it is methanogens which produce methane. So this which is utilized for the producing biogas. Okay, so it has to be option D, methanogens. Next question, again from NEET 2016. Don't think so many questions have been asked from NEET 2016. In 2016, NEET exam was held in two phases, phase 1 and phase 2. So in phase 1, some 3 to 4 questions and some 3 to 4 questions from phase 2 exam has been picked up. Okay. So which of the following statements is wrong for viroids? Their RNA is of high molecular weight. They lack a protein coat. They are smaller than viruses. They cause infections. So first of all, you know what are viroids? Viroids are infectious RNA particles, right? They don't have a protein coat. So they lack a protein coat. That is the correct statement. That cannot be the answer. They are smaller than viruses. Yes, they are minute. They are the smallest living cells, right? Sorry, mycoplasma is the smallest living cells. Viroids, they are smaller, minute particles than the viruses. Okay. Then they cause infections. Yes, viroids cause infections. It was first time found in the potato plant. So, where the disease caused was called as potato spindle tuber disease. Okay. Next, first option, their RNA is of high molecular weight. No, as I told you, they are small minute particles, smaller than the viruses. They have RNA of very low molecular weight. So the RNA is of low molecular weight. So it has to be the first option. Next, AIPMT 2015. So choose the wrong statement. Yeast is unicellular and useful in fermentation. Penicillium is multicellular and produce antibiotics. Neurospora is used in the study of biochemical genetics. Morels and truffles are poisonous mushrooms. So always read the question properly. Sometimes choose correct answer might be given. Sometimes it is given choose wrong statement. So you shouldn't get confused there. Okay. So see the options now. Yeast is unicellular and useful in fermentation. Yes, this is a right statement. Unicellular fungus is the only one, that is yeast, and yeast is useful for many purposes in the bakery products, like for the preparation of bread, buns. Okay, so there the sponginess, puffiness of those cakes or the buns, it is mainly because of the yielding of carbon dioxide gas. Why? Because of the fermentation which is brought about by yeast, right? The by preparing the dough of it. Okay, then next, it is also used in the preparation of alcoholic beverages like the wines, using the fruit juices, using sugar cane. So there yeast is added for them to allow for the purpose of fermentation, that is with fermentation products of this fermentation here will be alcohol and carbon dioxide is yielded. Okay, next, so that it cannot be the first option. Next option, penicillium is multicellular and produces antibiotics. Yes, so this is a general knowledge question, most of you should be knowing. The first antibiotic used was penicillin, right? Penicillin was the first antibiotic. So where did we get this penicillin from? So it was taken from the fungus Penicillium notatum. Right. Then next, Neurospora is used in the study of biochemical genetics. Yes, it is a group of fungi. So this is used for the genetical work. So in the studies of genetics. Then morels and truffles are poisonous mushrooms. No, previously in some questions, I think we have discussed morels and truffles are edible delicacies, right? So edible in the sense which can be consumed. Yes, so those are edible mushrooms. So they are not poisonous, they are edible mushrooms. So what is the answer, children? It has to be Fourth option is the wrong statement. Next question. In which group of organisms the cell walls form two thin overlapping shells which fit together? Slime molds, chrysophytes, euglenoids, dinoflagellates. So, see the first one, slime molds. So, slime molds, they are nothing but small, microscopic, they are unicellular. They form amoeboid-like structures called as the plasmodium, right? Or they are the aggregates, form aggregates of plasmodium. So, there, the cell wall doesn't form the overlapping structure. Next, you have the chrysophytes. So, yes, it is in the chrysophytes example, we have studied diatoms. So, where the cell wall is divided into two valves. Okay, so we can give the example of a soap box, how they fit into each other. So, this is how the cell wall is made. So, one half of the cell wall, one valve, or we can call it as, or one shell you can call it as, it fits into the other. This is the inner valve. It is also called as the valve or the shell. This is the inner valve which fits into the outer valve. So, they are overlapping with each other. So, this is in the chrysophytes, example diatoms. You can find this nature. Okay, euglenoids example, you know euglena, so their hole you have a pellicle. It is not a cell wall actually, they don't have a cell wall. They have a flexible membrane present called as the pellicle. Then dinoflagellates, cell wall is present but they don't have the overlapping cell wall. Okay, so the option has to be option B. Next question, again from PMT 2015, choose the wrong statement. Mosaic disease in tobacco and AIDS in human beings are caused by viruses. The viroids were discovered by D.J. Ivanovsky. W.M. Stanley showed that viruses could be crystallized. The term contagium vivum fluidum was coined by M.W. Bijring. So see here. Mosaic disease in tobacco. So, as you have studied, when was the viruses discovered? How? So, it was actually in the tobacco plant, right? So, when Ivanovsky was studying about this tobacco plant, the disease caused in tobacco plant, he could extract some fluid, some materials from the tobacco plant which was infectious in nature. So, that was called as the tobacco mosaic disease. And then AIDS, you all know AIDS is caused by HIV virus. So, both of these are caused by viruses. So, first option cannot be the answer. Viroids were discovered by D.J. Ivanovsky. No, it was virus which was discovered by D.J. Ivanovsky. Okay, so who discovered the viroids? It is actually Diener who discovered viroids. Not Ivanovsky. Okay, so the option is option B. Viroids were discovered by Diener, not Ivanovsky. So option B is the correct answer. Next, see the next statements. W.M. Stanley showed that viruses could be crystallized. Yes, it is true. As we all say, viruses are inert when they are present outside the host body, right? So he could show that they could also be stored in a crystallized form. Next option is the term contagium vivum fluidum was coined by Bijring. Yes, so when he was studying this infectious particle, he could see that the extract of the tobacco plant, when it was injected into a healthy tobacco plant, it could spread the infection. So that fluid was called as, the extracted fluid from the tobacco plant was called as the contagious infectious fluid or contagium vivum fluidum. Fine. So that was given by Bijring. So option here is option B. Next question, again from 2015 paper. The imperfect fungi, which are decomposers of litter and help in mineral cycling, belong to ascomycetes, deuteromycetes, basidiomycetes, phycomycetes. So always remember, in all these four groups of fungi, imperfect fungi, the name given is to this, deuteromycetes. Because why do we call them as imperfect fungi? Because they do not show sexual reproduction, or the sexual reproduction has not yet been discovered in this group of fungi. So they are called as the imperfect fungi. Okay, so it has to be option B. Next question, PMT 2014. Which of the following shows coiled RNA strand and capsomeres? Poliovirus, tobacco mosaic virus, measles virus, retrovirus. So this you have studied about TMV, right? Tobacco mosaic virus. The structure of TMV, what does it show? They have coiled RNA, single strand of RNA, which is covered by small units, okay, called as the capsomeres. So this whole protein coat is called as the capsid, and each of those units of the capsid are called as the capsomeres. So it has to be option B, tobacco mosaic virus. Next question, this is from NEET 2013. Pigment containing membranous extensions in some cyanobacteria are basal bodies, pneumatophores, chromatophores, heterocysts. So see the options here. Basal bodies, pneumatophores, these two you don't find in cyanobacteria. Next, coming to chromatophores. Chromatophores are the pigment containing structures which are found in the cyanobacteria and which consist of the pigments meant for photosynthesis in cyanobacteria. Okay, so it has to be option C. If you see heterocysts, heterocysts, you know, they are nothing but specialized cells present in the cyanobacteria which are meant for nitrogen fixation. So chroma means color, so they are pigment containing structures. Okay, so this is from it is option C. So this is from NEET 2013, children. So I have discussed questions from NEET 2020 to NEET 2013 till 2013. Why? Because from 2013 onwards, it was this NCERT textbook, prescribed textbook, which has been following since till now, till date. Okay. So many questions I have tried to cover here, almost all the questions from these previous year question papers. So hope this will be helpful for you. You can just get an idea how the questions can be framed, right? So read the NCERT book thoroughly. Everything, almost everything, if you, it is from the NCERT textbook itself. So if you just go through the NCERT textbook, any type of questions, whether it is a direct question or something which you have to think logically, so any type of question will be easier for you to solve if the concept is clear. Okay, so based on these questions, you can just go on solving many more questions, because more you practice, more you become perfect. Practice makes man perfect, that everyone you know. So that is why don't stop it for here only these many questions. See that how much ever books you get, go on solving as many type of different questions, so that will make you perfect. Fine. So with this I end my session. Hope you have understood. All the best for you all. Thank you very much.